everybody. So I have gotten almost an overwhelming number of requests to explain the science behind using the no poo method, which is basically no poo means no shampoo. So you could have a conditioner only method, or baking soda and vinegar method, or just using plain water. And today I'm going to go over the baking soda and vinegar method because I found it to be pretty interesting. But I really want to let you guys know that this is not me speaking from personal experience. This is me just discussing the theory behind it. There are probably hundreds of other people out there who use baking soda and vinegar to wash their hair, but I don't personally use it. That's not to say that I will never use it, but I just want you to be clear about that. So it's not as if I am recommending this method. However, it does sound interesting, so I would be willing to try it in the future. So first I'm going to start with baking soda, and baking soda is the common term for sodium bicarbonate. And sodium bicarbonate is a salt. The positive ion is the sodium, and the negative ion is the bicarbonate, which is the chemical structure HCO3. Sodium bicarbonate is amphoteric, so depending on the environment you put it in, it could act as either an acid or a base. So it could release carbonic acid, which is more acidic, or it could release hydroxide, which is more basic. So when you dissolve it in water, which is pH neutral, then it breaks down initially into its salt components. So you have your sodium ion, which just kind of hangs out until it finds something else negatively charged to hang onto, and it also breaks down into the carbonate. The carbonate itself can actually break down further into carbonic acid and hydroxide. And that carbonic acid can break down one more time actually into just carbon dioxide and water. So this carbon dioxide is the same carbon dioxide that you breathe out, the same carbon dioxide that you find in carbonated drinks, the bubbles that come up. So since the carbonic acid breaks down in water and the hydroxide does not, then dissolving baking soda into a water solution tends to make it more basic. So when your hair is dirty and you find it to be, you know, sweaty or greasy, that's a mix of sweat and also sebum, the sort of waxy substance that your scalp produces to help moisturize your skin and your hair. And sebum has several components in it. It can have waxes or esters, which are typically very, very insoluble in water. It can have triglycerides, which, if you remember in some of my previous videos, triglyceride is basically three fatty acids that are locked up with a glycerin or a glycerol molecule. And then you have free fatty acids that are floating around in the sebum as well, and squalene. So a lot of these are, you know, they're very oily, they're very hard to dissolve in water. So that is why you have a lot of soaps or surfactants that have a long hydrophobic carbon chain, and you have a short hydrophilic area that can grab onto water and grab onto the oil at the same time and then wash it away. So how is baking soda as a salt, as a naturally charged molecule, able to actually wash away something that is hydrophilic? So like I said before, a huge amount of the sebum that you produce is comprised of fatty acids, and actually some fatty acids are also released in your sweat. And fatty acids are a carboxylic acid, which means that it has a COOH group at the end of the molecule. So this can actually react in a mild acid-base reaction with the hydroxide that came off of the sodium bicarbonate. So basically the hydroxide molecule rips a hydrogen away from the fatty acid, and it basically turns into water and it washes away. Meanwhile, you have this fatty acid group with the long carbon chain, which is hydrophilic as usual, but it now has a charged group. It has a highly hydrophilic group at the end of this chain because the oxygen atom, which is now negatively charged, it no longer has that proton to make it neutral and charged to make the molecule happy. So it might grab onto the sodium ion that was just floating around before to make it a salt. And this, my friends, is a surfactant. So in other words, the sodium bicarbonate itself has an acid-base reaction with the oils, with the fatty acids in your hair, to literally turn the fatty acids themselves into a surfactant, into the soap that is going to then turn around and be able to grab onto the waxes, the esters, the squalenes, all the other highly hydrophobic things in your hair that need grabbing onto to be washed away. So literally it's transforming the oil into soap. I believe that the second highest part of the sebum in your hair is comprised of the triglycerides. And the natural flora that live on your body, on your skin, and on your hair, the bacteria, they can feed on these triglycerides and break them down into free fatty acids and glycerol. So those free fatty acids can react with the baking soda as well to turn into a surfactant. But it's also worth noting that although the baking soda does sort of transform the fatty acids into a mild surfactant, it is not as effective as the surfactants that you're used to in conventional shampoos. So it's going to take a while. It's going to take an adjustment period, anywhere between a few weeks to a few months, to see if this is going to work for you. And not only is it sort of an adjustment period to clean out the buildup from certain products that you're using, but also you're teaching your scalp to not overproduce sebum the same way that it did before. If you use very harsh detergents on your hair and on your scalp, then your scalp learns to compensate for this by overproducing sebum to sort of get back to status quo as quickly as possible. But if you're stretching your washes, or if you are using a less harsh detergent that clears away those oils, your scalp has to learn to tone it down a little bit and produce less sebum over time. So from what I understand, you need to dilute the baking soda before you use it, so you don't use it as a paste on your head or anything. That could be a little bit difficult to rinse. Although on a sort of macroscopic level, baking soda is pretty abrasive, and so it might help to exfoliate your scalp. However, that might be very drying for your hair. It might be a little bit too harsh, since baking soda is obviously alkaline. So from reading forums, some people use a 1-in-4 dilution. So say 1 teaspoon of baking soda to 4 teaspoons of warm water right before you use it. Some other people use about 1 teaspoon for an entire cup of water. So it might take some experimentation for you to figure out which dilution is right for you, if you've tried it or if you want to try it. And for those of you who do use this method on a regular basis, please comment down below and let me know what sort of dilution you use. Now that we understand how the baking soda, or the sodium bicarbonate, actually cuts the grease in your hair, let's now move on to the vinegar step. So a lot of people use vinegar as a rinse after the baking soda step. So whether you use apple cider vinegar or whether you use white or distilled vinegar, the basic main functional component is still the same. It's acetic acid, not acetic acid, which is kind of tautologous, but acetic acid with the T. Most vinegar that you find for domestic or consumption purposes are around a 4-5% dilution already. And if you're going to use this for your hair, then many people recommend diluting it in a 1-in-4 solution once more, so that you get about 1% acetic acid when you're doing the vinegar rinse. When you have full strength, like industrial or like chemical lab full strength acetic acid, that has a pH of almost 0. That is enough to actually burn through your skin. So obviously don't look for anything that says full strength acetic acid. So the vinegar being an acid, it actually helps to soften your water as well. So it can break down the mineral deposits that are left on your hair from hard water. It can also break down and wash away some of the soap scum that might be left over from some of your products, or some of the more alkaline residues that are left over from some of your hair products. And it can also help to pick up and wash away any salts, either from your sweat or the leftover salts from your baking soda wash. The vinegar also helps to neutralize any leftover baking soda and restore the pH of your hair. So your hair is covered in a cuticle, and if you look at this cuticle underneath a microscope, it literally looks like shingles of a roof, and they're all overlapping like that. When you put the hair in an alkaline environment, it can cause the shingles to sort of fly up. It can cause the cuticle to fly up. And so this is what makes your hair look a little bit rough. It might feel a little bit less smooth, might make it look a little bit less shiny. Not only that, but the cuticle is made to protect the core of your hair. And so if it's kind of flying up like that, then the same way that rain can sort of get into a roof and cause a sort of rot damage from the wood scaffolding of your house, your hair is exposed to the elements, and you can acquire more damage that way, or it can lose moisture that way. So the vinegar can help to make those cuticles lie flat by neutralizing the pH again. So this helps to seal in moisture, it helps to protect your your hair against damage from your regular environment, and it can also make your hair look and feel a little bit smoother. And if you've ever studied the physics of how light bounces off of reflective surfaces, like say a mirror, you know that rough surfaces or dull surfaces are actually due to the surface being very jagged or irregular. So when light comes in, when a ray of light comes in, it's scattered because those rough surfaces are making it kind of fly every which way. If you have a smooth surface, then basically any light that comes in on an angle, more of it is going to bounce off in the same angle, and if this reaches your eye, you perceive it as being shiny. So everybody seems to want shinier hair, so you can do this by using the vinegar rinse, which helps the cuticle to lie more flat. And so any light coming in bounces off your hair, and more light shines off in the same direction, which hits your eye and makes you perceive your hair as shiny, kind of like very, very tiny mirrors on your hair. So I hope this helped to explain how both baking soda and vinegar work to clean your hair and seal in moisture, help to protect your hair and make it look shinier. So if you liked this video, please remember to click that like button. It helps support my channel. And feel free to leave comments or questions down below and leave me your 2 cents. Let me know if you have tried the baking soda method and if it's worked for you or if it didn't work for you. Let me know if the science behind this you find to be right on the ball or if it's completely wrong. If you think it's wrong, then let me know how you think it works. And I will see you in a few days for the next video. Bye.